네, 안녕하세요. 오케이. 예, 네, 안녕하세요. 우리가 이제 계속 이제 그 out of order processor architecture에 대해서 계속 이제 배워보고 있는데, 오늘은 이제 또 out of order processor 이제 다른 테크닉 좀더 이제 발전되는 방향으로 이제 이 프로세서 구조를 설명한다라고 했죠. 그 out of order processor 이제 더 발전하는 그런 방향, 뭐 최신 프로세서의 어떤 구조에 대해서 이제 더 설명을 하도록 하겠습니다. 뭐그 전에 이제 우리가 이제 저번 시간에 배웠던 것이 이제 기억이 나야 될 텐데요. 저번 시간에 우리는 이제 그 스페큘레이티브 이제 토마술로에 대해서 이제 배웠습니다. 사실 이제 스페큘레이티브 이제 토마술로 로 이제 가게 되면서 그 토마술로 알고리즘이 이제 가지고 있었던 기본적인 퍼포먼스 바틀넥, 그게 뭐였죠? 그 인스트럭션을 우리가 브랜치 인스트럭션 이후로 수행을 아웃 오브 오더로 수행시킬 수 없다라는 거, 그것이 이제 가장 큰 퍼포먼스 이제 바틀넥이라고 이제 우리가 이제 배웠습니다. 근데 우리 이제 스페큘레이티브 익스큐션은 이제 그 토마술로 알고리즘에서 어떤 블럭이 이제 추가가 됐다? 예, 뭐가 추가가 됐나요? 리오더 버퍼. 이 리오더 버퍼가 이제 가장 그 중요한 그런 뭐 하드웨어 컴포넌트, 그러니까 스페큘레이티브 익스큐션을 위한 가장 중요한 하드웨어 이제 컴포넌트가 이제 되겠고요. 그 다음에 이제 브랜치 프레딕션, 그 다음에 브랜치 타겟 버퍼, 요두 가지는 브랜치 인스트럭션 이후로 더 우리가 이제 스페큘레이티브리 그 인스트럭션을 execution 하기 위해서 어쨌든 필요한 그런 블럭이라고 이제 보면 되겠습니다. 어쨌든 요 브랜치 프레딕션 버퍼는 이제 다이나믹 브랜치 프레딕터라고 이제 보면 되겠는데요. 어쨌든 다이나믹 브랜치 프레딕터는 우리가 그 전전 시간에 배웠던 것처럼 브랜치 인스트럭션의 그 트렌드, 그 히스토리를 보고서 우리가 이제 이후에 그 퓨처 이벤트, 브랜치의 이제 퓨처 이벤트를 우리가 이제 프레딕션 하는 그런 하드웨어라고 이제 보면 되겠습니다. 뭐 그다음에 이제 레지스터를 이제 뭐랄까? 그 레지스터 리네이밍 이제 발생하는데, 레지스터 리네이밍은 그전 토마술로 알고리즘에서는 어디를 가지고서 register rename을 했다라고 그랬죠? issue queue에 이제 entry number를 가지고서 이제 rename을 했다라고 하면은 이제 그 speculative 이제 토마술로는 rob entry number로 이제 register rename을 이제 한다라고 이제 보면 되겠습니다. 어쨌든 그렇기 때문에 그 register 그 instruction이 access를 하려는 register, 이거 operand죠. 그 operand의 이제 상태를 그 로깅을 해놓는 register alias 테이블이 이제 들어가게 됐습니다. 그래서 요 새로 추가되는 요 하드웨어 요거를 여러분들이 잘 알아놔야 되겠고요. 특히 뭐 물론 이제 토마술로 알고리즘이 그 out of order processor 이제 가장 기본적인 알고리즘이긴 하지만, 그 modern processor 우리가 쓰는 그럼 모던 프로세서의 같은 경우에는 요 스페큘레이티브 익스큐션이 그 퍼포먼스를 이제 가장 그러니까는 확 효율적으로 증가시키게 되는 어떤 획기적인 그런 프로세서의 이제 가 발전한 그런 방향이라고 이제 우리가 생각할 수가 있고요. 뭐 그렇기 때문에 여러분들이 out of order 프로세서다라고 하게 되면은 기본적으로 요 스페큘레이티브 익스큐션이 들어간 프로세서다라고 이제 보는 것이 뭐 거의 이제 그렇게 이제 생각을 하는 것이 이제 맞습니다. 그래서 이제 요새 쓰는 거의 대부분의 그 하이 퍼포먼스 프로세서 같은 경우, 특히나 이제 우리 ARM 같은 경우에도 이제 스마트폰도 점점 이제 하이 퍼포먼스 프로세서가 이제 쓰이고 있죠. 그러니까 우리가 보통 생각하는 그런 하이 퍼포먼스 프로세서 같은 경우에는 이런 아웃 오브 오더 프로세서 플러스 스페큘레이티브 익스큐션이 가능한 그런 구조로 설계가 되어 있습니다. 자, 그런데 이제 문제는 무엇이냐? 이렇게 이제 테크닉들이 하나씩 들어가게 되면은 물론 이제 코스트 문제가 이제 발생을 하게 되겠고요. 특히나 요 스페큘레이티브는 우리가 이제 브랜치 프레딕션을 프레딕션이 들어가는 거예요. 그러니까는 우리가 이제 프레딕션이 들어간다는 거는 프레딕션이 틀릴 경우에는 어쨌든 우리가 롤백을 해야 됩니다. 그 롤백을 위해서 이제 리워드 버퍼가 이제 여기 이제 들어가 있는 있게 되는 거고요. 어쨌든 롤백을 하려면은 우리가 지금까지 인스트럭션 계산했던 것들을 다 취소를 시키고 그 다음에 옛날 상태로 돌아가서 다시 또 인스트럭션을 수행을 하고 뭐 그렇기 때문에 실제로 그 수행해야 되는 인스트럭션 개수보다 컴퓨터 프로세서가 수행을 하는 인스트럭션들이 더 많아지게 되겠죠. 어쨌든 이거는 뭐 필수적인 것이 역시 우리가 이제 뭐랄까 퍼포먼스를 이제 증가를 시켜야 되기 때문에 프레딕션 해가지고 계속 아직 준비가 안 돼. 어쨌든 안 됐지만은 계속 수행을 해보는 거예요. 그래서 물론 이제 프레딕션이 퍼센테이지가 높다라고 했죠. 퍼센테이지가 높긴 한데 그 어쨌든 틀리게 되면은 다시 롤백을 해야 돼요. 그 롤백을 한다라는 거는 그만큼의 인스트럭션을 우리가 헛되이 뭐그 전기를 써가지고 일렉트릭 파워를 써가지고 우리가 수행을 했다. 뭐 그렇기 때문에 뭐예요? 전기가 더 많이 그러니까는 파워를 좀더 소비를 하게 됩니다. 그 파워 그래서 파워 컨섬션이 늘어나게 되는 것이죠. 우리가 이제 그첫 번째 챕터에서 이제 역시나 첫 번째인가 어쨌든 그 앞부분에서 이제 파워랑 물론 퍼포먼스의 관계 뭐 거기서는 이제 프리퀀시랑 뭐 에어리어랑 그다음에 뭐 볼티지 이런 여러 가지 그런 약간 피지컬한 그런 요소를 가지고서 그 파워를 이제 계산을 했죠. 물론 이제 그런 부분들도 이제 파워를 증가시키는 중요한 요소이긴 하지만 우리가 이제 지금 배우고 있는 것처럼 그 아키텍처럴 디벨롭먼트, 그러니까 새로운 아키텍처, 예를 들어서 이런 아웃 오브 오더 위드 스페큘레이티브 익스큐션이 들어가게 되는 경우에는 퍼포먼스도 증가하죠. 퍼포먼스 증가하지만 역시나 파워도 거기에 어쨌든 그 파워도 증가를 하게 됩니다. 뭐 이런 부분들을 뭐 우리가 이제 생각을 하면서 이제 그 어쨌든 프로세서를 이제 설계를 하게 되는 것이죠. 그래서 이렇게 이런 아키텍처에 따라 가지고 뭐 퍼포먼스라든지 파워 컨섬션이라든지 에너지 컨섬션 이런 그 프로퍼티 그럼 캐릭터리스틱스가 결정이 되기 때문에 우리가 그 사용하는 용도에 맞게 그 컴퓨터 프로세서를 선택을 하고 또 컴퓨터 프로세서를 설계를 하게 되는 것이죠. 뭐 예를 들어서 그리고 모바일에 써야 된다. 그럼 근데 파워가 이제 중요하겠죠. 요새는 이제 파워 플러스 퍼포먼스도 이제 중요하지만 뭐 옛날 같은 경우에는 어쨌든 파워가 제일 중요하죠. 파워랑 사실은 에너지가 중요하죠. 에너지. 그 에너지의 에너지 이피션트한 그런 구조를 이제 우리가 설계를 해서 그런 모바일 프로세서에 이제 사용을 할 수가 있겠고요. 서버 같은 경우에는 가장 중요한 거는 뭐 파워도 중요하지만 서버에서는 퍼포먼스가 중요하죠. 역시나 트루풋도 중요하죠. 뭐 그렇기 때문에 서버 같은 경우에는 이제 파워를 좀더 쓰더라도 또 하이어 퍼포먼스를 지원하는 그런 프로세서 구조로 설계를 하게 됩니다. 예, 그런 부분들을 다 염두를 해둬야 되고요. 자, 그래서 아까도 말했듯이 이제 스페큘레이티브 익스큐션 위드 토마스 로이 부분, 토마스 로 위드 스페큘레이티브 익스큐션 이 부분은 모든 프로세서의 가장 이제 기본이 되는 그런 구조라고 이제 볼수 있겠고요. 특히 ROB가 어떻게 동작을 하는지, 리워드 버퍼 이 부분이 어떻게 동작을 하는지를 여러분들이 잘 이해를 해 두어야 됩니다. 그리고 이제 리워드 버퍼의 이제 사실은 역할은 무엇을 분리를 시킨다고 했죠? 리워드 버퍼는 커밋과 Complete을 분리를 시키는 거죠. 자, 그러니까는 여기 이제 Retire 혹은 Commit 혹은 Graduate 이렇게 뭐 한다고 했는데 그 Execution이 끝나는 타이밍하고 그 다음에 실제로 그 끝난 execution이 그 컴퓨터 하드웨어에 업데이트가 되는 거. 뭐 이런 거는 뭐예요? 업데이트가 된다라는 거는 뭐 실제로 레지스터를 쓴다. 이런 것이랑 그다음에 뭐가 있죠? 뭐 메모리에 이제 값을 쓴다. 뭐 아니면 브랜치가 실제로 수행이 된다. 뭐 이런 것처럼 실제로 이제 컴퓨터의 그 스테이터스를 바꾸는 부분을 우리가 이제 커밋 혹은 뭐 리타이어먼 혹은 그레듀에이션이라고 이제 이야기를 합니다. 그래서 이제 그 스페큘레이티브 이제 엑스큐션은 요 엑스큐션 컴플릿 오브 엑스큐션하고 그다음에 커밋을 분리를 시킨다라는 거. 그 여러분들이 이제 잘 뭐랄까 기억을 해야 되고요. 그 생각을 해야 되는 거고요. 그래서 요 표, 그 테이블에 이제 보듯이 요 retire라는 그 컬럼이 이제 새로 생기게 됩니다. 요 분리를 시켰기 때문에 스페큘레이션이 가능한 거예요. 왜냐면은 그 브랜치 같은 경우에는 수행이 되면은 어쨌든 업데이트가 되는 거기 때문에 그 업데이트를 그 temporary 그 브랜치 이후의 인스트럭션의 결과를 temporary 어떤 space 이게 리로드 버퍼죠. 그 리로드 버퍼에 이제 전용해 놓고 그게 맞으면은 그대로 그 업데이트를 하고 틀리면은 어떻게 해요? 다시 롤백을 하고 뭐 이런 식으로 동작을 하는 것이죠. 예. 그래서 이 부분 어떻게 이제 인스트럭션이 이제 수행이 되는지를 여러분들이 잘 이해를 하면은 좋겠습니다. 그래서 이제 이번 시간에는 이제 레지스터 리네이밍이라는 그런 테크닉 아웃오브 오더 프로세서에서 이제 레지스터 리네이밍이 이제 들어가게 되는 그런 구조에 대해서 이제 설명을 하도록 하겠습니다. 그래서 in the previous class we learned about the Thomas' law algorithm with the speculative execution and then the major feature of this speculative execution is that the computer processor includes the reload buffer. So in the reload buffer, the reload buffer is actually the temporary space for the completed instruction. So what is the operation of the completed execution? So as I mentioned, what's the okay. I will write here. So what does the completed instruction do in the computer hardware? The first, the it write register. So this is actually architectural registers, and then write data to memory, and then perform branch. So these are the some examples of the update of the completed instruction. So as I mentioned, the speculative execution means that the hardware separate the completion of execution and then commit of execution. So how this process make work in the real hardware? How does this process make work? So actually, so when the execution is completed, so what does completion mean? The instruction is issued to the functional unit, and then functional unit complete the calculation of the instruction. So if the this processing is completed, then the result is will be generated. So for example, add R1, R2, R3. So this is the destination register. So what is the completion of this execution? Actually, the commit of this execution. So that means retirement. So when this instruction is committed, then the generated data R2 plus R3 is stored to the R1. But the feature, main feature of this speculative execution is that we can postpone the this commit of the this execution. So how can we postpone the writing of the some generated result or some completed calculation? So that means that ROV has an entry, and then in this entry the completed result, so calculated result, can be temporarily stored in the ROV entry. So actually the ROV entry is the some temporary storage space for the completed execution, completed instructions. Okay, so what is ROV? It's the temporary storage space for the completed instructions. Okay, so this is ROV. But what's the problem is that ROV is not a memory unit. So actually the ROV is the FIFO, so first in, first out structure. So actually the ROV stores the many data, and then also ROV has the many control signals. So it's a very complex. So it's a hardware structure is very complex. So problem, and then but problem is that in the ROV we need to also store the completed data. So completed instruction data. So then is that it's some data executed by the completed instruction. So the ROV structure, so actually the ROV structure is very complex, and then this structure is very expensive. So because the structure is very complex. So and then but we need to also store the some temporary data in the ROV, but if the data is stored in the some hardware unit, then the size of the this hardware unit is also increased largely. So that's the problem. ROV is very complex. It's a ROV is the very actually the expensive hardware structure. But we need to also store some very data. Store data, like for example, so 64-bit data to the ROV entry. So ROV, but all the instruction does not require the some temporary data, so storage space for the temporary data. Only the R-type instruction and load instruction requires the storage space for the temporal data, the completed data. But other instructions such as the store and the branch instruction, the control instruction, does not require the data for some temporary storage space for the completed data. So this is also waste of the hardware resources. And then the another issue is that the data also is stored in the very complicated hardware structure, so it is also waste the hardware resource. So if we want to store the data and the actually the large amount of data in the hardware, then it's better to have the dedicated memory space for this large amount of data. So what is the dedicated memory unit in the hardware, in the computer hardware? Actually, the register file, also stores the large amount of data. So actually, the size is small, but in the hardware unit, the size of data is large. Also, cache memory, so SRAM, also stores the large amount of data. So this is the just a memory unit. And then this memory unit does not include the control part. Actually, very simple control part. It includes a very simple control part, the minimum control part. But if the data is stored in the, this memory unit, then we can increase the efficiency of the some hardware cost, because the memory unit has the very simple hardware structure. So the idea of the register renaming is that the physical register file, the size of the physical register file can be larger than the architectural register file. So actually this number of architectural registers is defined in the instruction set architecture. So for example, the number of registers like R0, R1, R2, this is the registers. So this number of registers is defined by the instruction set architecture. So the compiler has the some information of the number of registers. So compiler optimized the execution of the compiled instruction within the allowed resource. That is the number of architectural registers. But in the previous class, we learned that in the Tomasello algorithm, the instruction, the issue queue, the entry of the issue queue work as the renamed register file. Also, in the speculative execution, the ROB entry works as the renamed registers. So that means that this is the some additional space for the temporary data, and then this temporary data has the some requires the some larger space. So this is the some space for the temporary data, and then this the tag of the issue queue or the ROB entry number works as the renamed register number for the this temporary data. So that means that issue tag or the ROB entry number is the actually the register renamed. So idea is that this is the actually the renamed register. So that means that if there are so larger space for the this renamed register, then we can implement the out of order processor with the this larger space. I said it's the larger. So what does larger mean? So actually in the Tomasello algorithm and the speculative execution, the instruction queue entry and then ROB entry works as the some space for the temporary register data. So idea is that this temporary register data can be stored in the some dedicated memory unit. It's actually the register file. But this register file size can be larger than the architectural register file. So architectural register file is defined by the instruction set architecture, for example, number 32. But the physical register file, so this is the actual register file inside of the computer processor, and then this size of the physical register file can be larger than the architectural register file. Then what is the benefit of this larger physical register file? We can store temporary data in the this larger physical register file, right? So that means that the data stored in the instruction the data stored in the issue queue or ROB entry can be stored in the this physical register file. Then what is required? So actually the instruction like add R1, R2, R3, so actual instruction use the architectural register number. like R1, R2, R3. But the physical register file size is larger than the architectural register file size. So that means that the number of physical registers is larger than the number of architectural registers. So we need to map these register numbers, architectural register numbers, to the physical register number. So we need the mapping table. So this mapping table translates the architectural register number to the physical register number. So this mapping table is required. And then, so this register renaming technique exploit this mapping mapping mechanism to that translate the architectural register to the physical registers. So, and then with this mapping mechanism, the register renaming include the larger physical register file, and then using this larger physical register file, the out-of-order processing can be implemented. So actually the idea is very good. Actually idea is very simple. So some data, so in the previous architecture, the data, actually this data is stored in the issue queue entry or ROB entries, and then this is inefficient. So we has, so the some register renaming architecture has the larger physical registers, and then the architectural register is mapped to the physical register through this mapping table. And this mapping table is called the also register alias table or register renaming table. So this is the register renaming technique. So that means that the so in summary, in the register renaming technique means that the processor include the larger physical register file, and then the architectural register file is mapped to the physical registers. So we don't know, actually the compiler or programmer doesn't know which architectural register number is mapped to the which physical register number. But this mapping is managed by the computer hardware. So the compiler only knows about some architecture, only the number of number of architectural register number is a number of architectural register is revealed to the compiler only, but this architectural register is dynamically managed by the computer hardware. This technique is called the register renaming. So actually this is also a very important technique of for the modern processor architecture. So modern processors, most of the modern processor includes this register renaming technique. Also the GPU, graphical processing unit, also has this register renaming technique to support the large number of concurrent thread. Okay, so why register renaming is required technique for the modern computer processor. Then modern computer processor actually support the parallel processing, and then in order to support this parallel processing, so we need the larger number of register space. So because this architectural registers is allocated to the concurrent thread, each concurrent thread. So in order to support the larger number of concurrent thread, the register file size has also been large. So we need a large register file. And then this large register file is the physical register file. So architectural register should be mapped to this physical register file. So this is the idea of register renaming. So this slide summarized the register renaming techniques, and then as I explained already, the architectural registers are mapped to the mapped to the So map to the physical register. How? Dynamically. So only the architectural registers, number of architectural registers is revealed to the compiler and programmers. So the physical registers are dynamically managed by hardware. So this is the feature of the register renaming, and then obviously one architectural register may map the multiple physical register, and this is true also for the Thomas' law algorithm and speculative execution. Why? Like this one, add R1 is a destination register, and then sub R1 and load R1. So this destination register R1 is mapped the different entry of the ROB in the speculative execution. So I make ROB1, ROB entry 2, ROB entry 3. So even though the architectural register number is the same, and then before this instruction is committed, the result of this instruction is temporarily stored in the ROB entry 1, 2, 3. So that means that the same architectural register is mapped to the multiple ROB entries in the speculative execution. And then register renaming is the same. So that means that the one architectural register, like R1, can be mapped to the multiple physical register number, like P1, P2, P3. So in order to support the out-of-order processing, the register renaming also support the this one-to-multiple physical register mapping. And then this architectural register is mapped the physical register at dispatch. So this is actually the same to the speculative execution. So why? So the dispatch, okay? The architectural register is mapped to the physical register at dispatch. So actually it's the same. So when the instruction is dispatched, the architectural register number is mapped to the ROP entry at dispatch. It's the same to the speculative execution. So, and then this is whenever the instruction target a register at dispatch, a new physical register is allocated to the new value. It's the same to the register renaming and the speculative execution. So whenever the instruction is dispatched, the new ROP entry number is allocated, and then with the same way, the architectural register number is allocated to the new physical register number. It's the same. And then one physical register. So then physical register must hold the latest what? Committed. So this is also important. And then, so difference is different from the speculative execution. So in the speculative execution, the we separate the commit and completion of the execution. So the ROP entry can hold the temporary data, the completed data actually. So this data is not updated to the register files. So when this data is updated, if the data instruction is committed, the data is updated to the register file. But in the register renaming, the computer processor only has the one physical register file. So that means that in the speculative execution, the computer, the computer processor has the two different storage memory unit for the, and the one memory unit, so one memory unit, for example. So this is the register file, and this is the ROV, and then the register file only holds the committed value, and then ROV has the completed value, it's a temporary value. But in the register renaming architecture, the computer processor has only one physical register file. So if the instruction is updated, that means that the instruction is committed, the result is so if the result is committed, the physical register number holds the is committed result only. So one physical register holds the latest committed value of the architectural register. And this is the some different part of the this register renaming. And then it's the feature of the register. Physical registers must be reclaimed, and then ROV entry also, and then ROV entry does not store the this completed data. So ROV entry just holds this mapping information to the from the architectural register to the physical register. And then this is obvious that can't dispatch instruction if all physical registers are allocated. This is obvious, because if the all physical registers are allocated, then new instruction, so dispatched instruction cannot allocate the architectural register to the physical register. So there is no hardware resources for the physical register number, so the instruction cannot be dispatched if all physical registers are allocated. So for this register renaming, we have the computer processor has the new component has the front end RAT, the register alias table, and retirement RAT. So this front end RAT point the latest value, actually the latest physical register mapped to the this architectural registers. And then retirement RAT, retirement RAT is called the RAT because it's a register alias table. Retirement RAT has the retired value, the latest retired value. So this retired value is the committed value to the architectural register. So there are two RAT, RAT, so front end RAT and retirement RAT. So this front end RAT points the most recent value. So that means that So there are two different kinds of RAT, it's a RAT, and then this RAT is the register alias table. And then actually the RAT has the mapping information from architectural register to physical register. And then there are two kinds of RAT, front-end RAT and the retirement RAT. And then this front-end RAT points the most recent value. So that means that if the instruction is dispatched the front end RAT is updated. So front end RAT finds the some available physical registers, and then if it, this front end RAT finds the available physical register, and then this front end RAT updates the some mapping information from the architectural register to the so this physical register. And then retirement RAT is updated when the physical register is the instruction is committed to the some corresponding physical registers. So this retirement RAT has the latest retired value, so most recent retired value. So if the and then it is also possible that the front end RAT and the retirement RAT has the points the same physical register number, and that is possible, like add R1. So this if this instruction is retired, and then after this the retirement of this instruction, and there is no architectural register number, the R1 is not mapped to any physical registers, then the front end RAT and the retirement RAT has the same mapping information for the architectural register number. And then let's see the some example of the front end RAT and then retirement RAT. So this front-end RAT, actually this is the, so I start with the example. It's like add R1, add R1, and then sub R1. So actually this instruction 1, 2, 3 has the same destination register number, R1, R1, R1. So actually architectural register, so use the same architectural register R1 as the destination register. So, what's that? Okay, I was interrupted again. So, this is the example of the multiple instructions, and then this multiple instruction has the same architectural register number R1 as the destination register. So how if the instruction is dispatched, then the front end the RAT is updated with the most recent value. So and then the physical register is also allocated, and then this allocation information, the mapping information, is logged in the this front end RAT. So if adding the first add instruction is dispatched, then R1 is, let us assume that the R1 is mapped to the physical register P1. So then the front end RAT is updated to the P1. It's like P1. And then the second add instruction is also dispatched. Then the front end RAT finds the available physical register, and then the P2, let us assume the P2 is the available. So in this case, the P2 is mapped to the architectural register R1. So, and then follow instruction, after this add instruction, so if the follow instruction needs to use the operand R1, then the follow instruction may use this value in the physical register P2. And then if the sub instruction is dispatched, then the another available physical register like P4 can be mapped to this physical register R1. So what is the function of this front end RAT? So function of the front end RAT is to map the most recent mapping information from the architectural register to the physical register. So we can think like that. After this first add instructions, like add R1, and then there can be some many other instructions which use the result of this add instruction. But because when the following instruction read this front-end read for the architectural register R1, then the following instruction can know that the physical register P1 is mapped to the architectural register R1. It's the most recent information, mapping information. So in this case, the following instruction, like some other instruction, if this the following instruction used requires the data from the R1, then P1 is actually mapped to the operand of the this following instructions. And then after that, the second instruction, second add instruction, R1, is also dispatched. And then in this case, this R1 is mapped to P2, the physical register P2. And then the following instruction, which use the result of this add instruction, use the physical number, can use the physical register number P2 as the operand. It's the same to the third sub instruction. So as the front end read points the most recent mapping information from architectural to the physical register number, then the following instruction after dispatch can use this physical register for the operand of their instruction. Okay, and then retirement read points the most recent retired value. So if the that means that if the physical register number is retired, then that means that the physical number can this physical register can be used by other actually as other instruction. Not always, but if the front end read and the retirement read is different, then this retirement the physical registers can be used by some other instructions. Actually, the physical register is also the limited hardware resource for the some register in the register file. So if the register file it can be used to, then if that means that the retirement read and then the mapping information of retirement read and the front end read is the different, then we can use this retired physical register as the available register for dispatch. Okay, so this is the also this retirement read has the information of the most recent committed value for each architectural register. So I said that this is the retired or committed value. Committed. Committed value. So that means this value is committed. So updated. Actually, the updated. Then the following instruction can use this updated value for their operand. So there are two different kinds of register alias table reads in the register renaming. So that means so as I explained, then more speculative values. So this is the completed value, but it's not committed yet. So this speculative value can exist in the register file. Also, the multiple speculative values can be mapped to the architectural registers. Okay, that is possible, and then that is also possible in the speculative execution and then the Thomas-Rolle algorithm. Okay, and then updating register. So what is the updating register? It's the some write back operation. So also the that is the some commit of the corresponding instruction. So updating register means then update the pointer in the retirement. So update the some this mapping instruction, mapping information and of the retirement thread. So this is the very important concept of the register renaming. So and then this is the operation of the register renaming combined with the out of order processor. So when the register and then is actually this slide also summarized the what I explained in the previous slide for the register list table. So when an instruction is dispatched, that means that the instruction is read from the instruction fetch queue, and then this instruction is dispatched to the issue queue of the functional unit. So when an instruction is dispatched, the operands are renamed. So what does renamed mean? So renamed means that the architectural register is mapped to the new physical register. So as the architectural register is mapped to the new physical register, so physical register is allocated to the destination register, only for the destination register, because only when the instruction is executed and committed, the destination register is updated by the calculated value or processed value. So the front end read is updated with this newly allocated physical register. So for example, if the R1 is actually in the previous example, if the R1 is mapped to the physical register P1, then the front end read is updated as for the register number R1 is updated to the P1. So this is front end read is updated. And then this physical register number mapped by this front end read is now works as the tag used in the Thomas law and the Thomas law. So tag. So actually in the Thomas law algorithm, we use the tag as the renamed register. But in this register renaming, the physical allocated physical register number is works as the renamed register number. Yeah. And then, so follow instruction may use the result of this instruction. So in the follow instruction, and then check the front end read, and then also read some mapping information for the architectural register. For example, this is the add R1, and then follow instruction may use this result of add instruction like sub R2, R1, R1, like. So in this case, the sub instruction requires the data from from add instruction. But we know that by checking the information of the front end read assigned to the architectural register R1, then we already know that the R1 is mapped to physical register P1. So instead of this architectural register R1, the physical register number is assigned to the operand of the following instruction sub. So actually the physical instruction is assigned. And then if the value is ready in the physical register, so that means that the physical register is retired or already completed, then the value can be dispatched also. So that value can be read from the physical register. But if not, if the instruction is located in the back end of the out of the processor, then the result is not ready yet. So in this case, the physical register number and then ready bit, non ready bit, actually it's a ready flag, is stored in the issue queue. And then when the instruction is retired, the destination physical register has the retired value, and then retirement read is updated. So if the, as I explained, if the this what's that, the retirement read and the what's that? The front end read has the different mapping information for the corresponding architectural register, then this retired physical register can be reclaimed. That means it is reused for the some future instruction. Okay, so this is the operation of the register renaming in the out of the processor. So this is the also the register renaming also support the speculative execution. So that means that if the branch is mispredicted, then the instruction can be rolled back. So the out of the processor roll back the instructions. So how can we roll back the instruction? So actually, so if the instructions are already committed, so retired, then this is not, so there is no change for the retired value. So, but the important information, actually the important process, critical process is to the between the front end read and retirement read. So there are many speculative values for the assigned to the architectural register, for example R1, between the this front end and read and the retirement read. So this the values already retired is the retired value, already committed value. So we don't need to consider the, this value, and then the this speculative value should be rolled back, so cancelled. So that means that is the cancelled. So that means that if the instruction is already completed, then completed value may exist in the physical register between the front end and then retirement read, but this physical register this value should be cancelled. And then in order to cancel the, this information, we can just update the this front end read to the retirement read. Okay, because only the retirement read is the some already committed value. But the branch is mispredicted, then that means that we need to roll back the instruction of so the branch is mispredicted, then we need to roll back the instruction in the ROB. Also we need to roll back the register address table. And then let's think about this issue. So how can we roll back the register alias table? So actually the register alias, there are two different kinds of alias table. So it's the front end and the retirement read. So actually the retirement read is not we don't need to care about the retirement read, because the retirement read has the information, mapping information of the retired architectural register. So it's already retired, so we don't need to care for the this retirement read. But the important thing is the we need to roll back the front end read. Now how can we roll back this front end read? So let's think about this example. So this is example is the add R1, and then there is a branch instruction here, and then sub R1. So let us assume that this branch is mispredicted, but the sub instruction is already dispatched. So, and then when the add instruction is dispatched, then I will use the different color. Okay. So if this add instruction is dispatched, and then this R1 can be map to the physical register P1, and then when this R2 is dispatched, then this architectural register is mapped to the different physical register P2. So in this case, when this sub instruction is dispatched, what is the content of the front end read for R1? It's the P2. So R1 is mapped to P2. And then let us assume that this branch is mispredicted. The branch is miss. So in this case, we need to cancel the following sub instruction. So there are two possible cases. So the first is the branch misprediction. Is handled when the branch is committed. So actually this case is very simple. So when the branch is committed, the misprediction is handled when the branch is committed. So that means that this add instruction is already committed, because in the speculative execution, the retirement of the instruction is in order, right? So what happened? So in this case, we can just simply, so actually this R1 is already retired because this add instruction is committed, and the branch instruction is committed. So in this case, we just change the front end read to the with the retirement read. So because this is already committed and this is not yet committed. So in this case, R1 to P1 is the valid mapping, but R1 to P2 is speculative and mispredicted mapping. So we need to cancel this mapping. But we already have the committed mapping information in the retirement read. So in this case, we can just change the front-end read to the retirement read. So just copy the retirement read to front-end read. And this is the simple. So this is this case. But but we can think about the second misprediction handling method. So what's the disadvantage of this handling method? So when the branch is branch misprediction is handled when the branch is committed, then there can be the very long time difference between the completion and commit of the branch instruction. So the problem is that the computer processor already knows the result of the branch instruction when the branch is completed here. But the computer processor cannot handle this mispredicted branch until this branch instruction is retired, committed. And then there are significant time gap between this completion and the commit of the branch instruction. So this is the disadvantage of this method. So second method is that the branch mispredicted can be handled when the branch is completed. So that is if the processor knows the result of the branch instruction, then the computer processor can handle this mispredicted branch right just after the branch instruction is completed. And then what is the problem? So let's see that this add run branch and sub R1. And then we in this instruction, the R1 is mapped to P1, and then this R1 is mapped to P2. And then branch is mispredicted. So problem is that even before this add instruction is retired, the branch misprediction can be detected. So in this case, the branch instruction, the processor can cancel the follow instruction like a sub instruction. So the problem is that the R1 is not yet committed. So we need to information of the this mapping information because this add instruction is not yet committed. But branch is completed, not yet committed, but processor knows the result of the branch instruction. So the control processor needs to cancel the this sub instruction, right? But problem is that the front end read has the information of R1 to P2 mapping, but we need the front end has the information of the R1 to P1 mapping when the branch misprediction is handled. So the instruction is rolled back to the top of the ROB, the branch instruction. So we need this information. So we need to recover the front end ROB as the R1 to P1 mapping information. So how can we come back to this information? So the advantage of this handling method is to handle the branch misprediction just after the branch is completed. So right after the branch is completed. But it's very hard to roll back the front end read out of the processor. So actually we can has some several method. So first method is just to make the snapshot of this front end read when the branch is dispatched, whenever the branch is dispatched. So when the branch is dispatched, then the control processor out of the processor makes the snapshot of this front end read and then store this snapshot. And then if the branch is mispredicted, then the out-of-order processor can recover this snapshot. That's very simple, but it requires the hardware cost will be very high. And then second method is to rebuild the map one by one from the retirement read by traversing the ROB backward from top of the ROB to the branch. So what does that mean? Actually, the ROB has the mapping information, and then each entry of the ROB include the mapping information, like architectural register to the physical register, like R1 to P1. So when the add instruction is dispatched, the ROB and one of the ROB entry is ROB entry is what does it mean? ROB entry is has the information of this mapping register mapping information, and then as the ROB has this register mapping information, then the instruction is retired, then this information is stored in the retirement read, right? So when this sub instruction is dispatched, then R1 to PT instruction is stored in the entry of the ROB corresponding to this sub instruction. And then here is this is the ROB yield buffer, and this is the sub, this is the branch, this is the add. And then, as the branch is mispredicted, then we need to cancel these ROB entries. Cancel these ROB entries. And then, well, actually, the canceling ROB entry is simple, that we can change this ROB pointer to the branch instruction, just after the branch instruction, right? But how can we restore the front end read? So, actually, this arrow entry has the information about the register mapping, like R1 to P1, and then so this means that the sub instruction has the R1 to P2 register mapping. And then when the ROP is rolled back, so actually the computer processor read the information of the each ROP and then recover the front and read based on this ROP information, the register mapping information stored in the ROP entry. So this is the what's that? Some traversal method of the ROP. And then the second method is let's start from the branch instruction and then also recover the front end read by traversing the branch to the top of the ROP. So actually actually the snapshot method is the most si simplest way, but it requires the very large amount of hardware to store the snapshot of the front end read for each architectural register. And then also the method 2 and 3 has is the some is a traversal method, but it may waste some clock cycles to traverse the ROP entries from bottom to the top of the ROP. So it will waste some clock cycles to traverse the ROP entries. So but maybe the branch misprediction penalty can be larger with the method 2 and 3. You don't need to consider about the retirement rate because it's the already retired value. And then if the exception occurs, then the same process is also applied for the exception. Okay. So in the register renaming, as the re register renaming is included in the out of order processor with the speculative execution, then we added the front end read and retirement read. So front end read is updated when the instruction is dispatched. So the front end read is located in the dispatch stage, and then the retirement read is updated when the instruction is committed in the ROP. So the retirement read received the information from the ROP. And then actually the data exists in the physical register file. So this is the physical register file here. And then this size of the physical register file is larger than the architectural register file. So actually in this, so in this example, the size of the architectural re actually the number of architectural register file register is the 32, but what is the number of the physical register? 127. So the size, actually 128. 128 is a different size, is different. So the operand instruction is only read from the physical register file. Okay, so that is the difference between the Thomas' law with the speculation and the Thomas' law algorithm. And then okay. So when the instruction is dispatched, then the register number is a physical register number, and then the ready bit is also dispatched with this instruction. So dispatched to the issue queue with the physical register number and ready bit. And then if the data exists in the physical register, then the data is dispatched to the issue queue, and then if not, then the ready bit and then physical register number is dispatched. So, and then the CDB also transfers value to the register. So let us assume that this is CDB. The CDB is connected to the physical registers, and then also the CDB is connected to the this issue queues of the functional unit. But this CDB, this bus just transfers the physical register number. When the data processing or some data fetch or some execution of the instruction is completed, then physical register number is transferred to the issue queue. And then the data is also trans data is also transferred to the physical register number. So this is the some this is very similar to the write back operation of the pipeline architecture. So the data is written back to the physical register file, and then if the data is completed, data processing or execution is completed, then the physical register number is also transferred to the issue queue. So the issue queue entry has the physical register number PR1 and then the ready bit. If the ready bit is 0, that means that the data is not ready in the this physical registers, then this instruction has the register number, physical register number, and then if the CDB gives this physical register number when the formal instruction complete some required execution, then this physical register number is matched with the CDB, and then the ready bit is changed to the 1. So if the all operand of the ready bits become 1, then the instruction can be ready to be issued to. So the instruction is ready to be issued. So I can instruction by setting ready bit in the issue queue. So for example, this is the add instruction, add R1, R2, R3. So these are the operand of this add instruction. And then, so when this add instruction is dispatched, then what that? This add instruction check the this front end read, and then find the mapped physical register for operand. So let us assume that the physical register for this R2 is the P4, and then this is the P6. And then if this data exists in physical register file, then with this physical register number is the data, and then ready bit 1 is sent to the issue queue. If not, its ready bit is set as the 0, and then physical register number is logged in the issue queue. So when this P6 is the formal instruction complete the execution for this P6 data, then the P6 register number is delivered via the common data bus, and then if the P6 is matched with the this issue queue of the P6, then the ready bit is changed to the 1, set as 1. So if two ready bits, the operands of the ready bit are all 1s, then the add instruction is ready to be issued. So when the add instruction, so in the register renaming structure, the register fetch stage is included. So actually the data is only fetched from the physical register file. So and then the data is only fetched in the register fetch stage. So the register values are fetched right before execution. So it's execution, and then So the one more stage is included in the register renaming. So problem is that latency is also increased. So is it because the register fetch is stage is included, so and then registers are the register values only fetched in the register fetch stage. So this is the some execution table of the register renaming. Actually, this example is the same. The example code is the same, but you can see that the register fetch stage is included in the with the register renaming. So when the instruction is issued, and then one cycle is assigned to the register fetch. So one cycle is included in the register for the register renaming with the register renaming structure. So you can compare the execution time of this example with the speculative Thomas law, and then in the speculative Thomas law, there is no register fetch stage. So actually, the latency from this fetch to the retire for this load instruction is 6, but with the register renaming, the latency is 7. So here, because the register fetch stage is included in the register renaming. Also, you can find the some final retire cycle for the instruction I-12. So what is the retire cycle? So 24. So you can find that. So the latency increased with the register renaming technique. But when we consider this hardware structure, as I said, that the efficiency of this physical register and then some hardware structure is simpler than the speculative Thomas law. So you can find the some clock cycles for each stage for each instruction here. So this is first load instruction, dispatch, load is dispatched to, and then issued, because the R1 is already ready. So actually the instruction is issued, the register is fetched from the physical register file, and then it takes one cycle. And then execution is completed and cache is accessed and retired at 7. And then the second load instruction is the same. And then this add instruction? So add instruction requires the data from this load instruction. So this add instruction wait until the load instruction complete its execution. So when the load instruction is complete its execution, the clock cycle 7. So when the clock cycle is 7, this add instruction wait until the load instruction is completed. So when the load instruction is completed at clock cycle 7. So when the for this clock cycle 7, the load instruction is completed, and then the destination register F1 is sent to the CDB. So the add instruction for this add instruction, actually when the add instruction is dispatched, the two operands F1 and F0 are not ready. So the ready bit is set as the 0, 0. And then when this first load instruction is completed, and then the ready bit for the F1 becomes 1, and then F0, sorry. And then when the second load instruction is completed, the ready bit for this F1 is ready. So when the CDB is the data is sent to the CDB at clock cycle 7, then the ready bit for these two operands are set as 1. So at the next clock, this add instruction can be issued to the floating point functional unit. Okay, so the add instruction is issued to the clock cycle A, and then 9 fetched, and then execution is started at clock cycle 5, and then completed at clock cycle 15, and then retired at 16. Also, so store instruction is the same, the address calculation, and then real store instruction is separate to the address calculation and the real store instruction. So actually the address can be easily calculated because the data is ready. But for this store instruction, wait for F2, because F2 should be completed by this add instruction. So at clock cycle 16, the store instruction can be issued and then completed. The store instruction can be retired at clock cycle 20, so it can access the cache at clock cycle 19. How about this add instruction? That add instruction can be issued before this store instruction. This is out of the processor, so this is adding, and then sub instruction is performed but retired after the store instruction 21 22 23. And then branch instruction wait for R3, because R3 is calculated by the sub instruction, and then completed at clock cycle 12. So actually this branch instruction can be issued at clock cycle 13, but this branch instruction will complete with the this instruction I10 and I11. So this is delayed by two cycles issued to 15. So it's here, and then the load instruction can be issued before the branch instruction here. So this is the clock cycle and the operation of the register renaming with Thomas algorithm. So register renaming is included. So actually the important thing is that register fetch stage is included. So one clock cycle is added to the original latency. So yeah, I will stop here, and then this is the so we learned about the register renaming. Actually the register renaming is very important topic also in the modern processor architecture. And then most of the modern processor has the larger physical register, so this register mapping technique is frequently used in the modern processor. Okay, if you have any question, then you can post your question on the blackboard or 피아자. 오케이. 수고 많으셨습니다. 예. 네. 아니 더럽다가 좀 많이 했는데 이해를 해주시고, 예. 네. 네, 수고 많았습니다.